Good afternoon, everyone. This is Chaitali Bhak from the European Bureau of Aviation and Defense Universe. With not so friendly neighbors and Indian Army facing a threat on all the borders, it is imperative to understand the threat and how prepared are we to combat it. We have with us retired Major General Dr. P.K. Chakravarti, BSM, former Additional Director General Artillery in ADU's chat room to discuss the modernization of the Indian Army's artillery vis-a-vis China and Pakistan. Welcome, sir. And I now request Editor Sangeeta Saxena, ADU, to take the discussion forward.
Thank you very much, Chaitali. Good evening, sir. Welcome to ADU's chat room. And, you know, it's just the right occasion, the Indian Army Day, which is a couple of days away. And of course, sir, the most important factor that we have, like Chaitali said, not so friendly neighbors. And we definitely want to know, sir, you are an expert. You've written a book on China and, of course, other books too. And, you know, nothing better than hearing of it from the horse's mouth. Mm-hmm. We want to understand, sir, that what are the threats apart from the routine? Yes, mm-hmm. The world knows we have threat from China. The world knows we have threat from Pakistan. But yes, what are the actual threats and how do we combat them? And we'll begin with, you know, since it's the Army Day and we are talking of Indian Army and you have your background of Indian artillery. So we'll begin with our question first, which is, how is our artillery different from China and Pakistan's? And are we absolutely at a level to combat them perfectly? And if not, then what else, what is lagging? And how do we fulfill our wish list?
Thank you, Sangeeta, and it's a very, very auspicious occasion. It will be the 74th Army Day on 15th of January, which is a little time away. And I would straight away not really get into any other issues, but straight away come to your question, which is, how is the Indian artillery different from the Pakistan and Chinese artillery? Well, firstly, I would say that as far as quality goes, I think the Indian artillery is any day far better than both the Chinese as well as the Pakistani artillery. And I would like to be very simplistic. I would not like to get into calibers and other things. Well, the Chinese artillery, well, they have most of the issues, you know, being done by the Norinco company, which are experts. The Chinese have become experts in what you call now innovating. I will not say copying. They've already crossed that stage of catch up and copy, and they've started innovating their own design. But bulk of the systems which we have, whether we talk of mortars, whether we talk of guns, whether we talk of rockets, whether we talk of self-propelled guns, whether we talk of surveillance devices, China has them. But definitely China has in greater quantity. Now, in terms of firepower, when you look at it, qualitatively, India is well matched at specific places. Now, when we look at China, we just can't look at Eastern Ladakh and feel very happy. We've got 50,000 troops over there. The Chinese line of actual control or the border spreads across, as I put it, you know, I mean to say, one Chinese command, which is the Western Theater Command. But as far as the Indian Army is concerned, it starts with Northern Command, it goes to Western Command, it goes to Central Command, and finally it goes on to possibly a border with Nepal, which we can say we are not involved. And then finally we come on to Eastern Command. So that it should tell you what is the spread. Now in this spread, if you want to analyze each sector, artillery can reach a point only when it is so well deployed that it can reach that point. Now, I'll just explain to you one sector. We are lucky that in Eastern Ladakh, now we have pumped in a lot of artillery. There were occasions before this when there was hardly any artillery. But today, when you look at rest of Arunachal Pradesh, as you know, Arunachal has got two parts of in terms of army deployment. You've got the Kameng sector and you've got the rest of Arunachal Pradesh. There are still areas where artillery cannot even reach the international border. Whereas the Chinese have built roads, they have built communications, enabling them to reach. So this reach is extremely important. Everywhere you can't open up with BrahMos. You'll say there's today as per newspaper reports, there are supposed to be a BrahMos regiment in Arunachal, a BrahMos regiment in Ladakh. Now, those are limited launchers. Artillery is something like a drummer. You know, in the battle, it has to keep drumming the beats for everybody else to fight. And today, when we look at it, we find that our numbers, which I've always stated, are still very low to meet a, what you call a full-spectrum war. And China's main areas, if I may put it, as far as artillery is concerned or anybody is concerned, Arunachal is their main claim, southern Tibet. Eastern Ladakh is primarily due to the fact that they want to see that their highway 219 and our building of the highway both have possibly caused China to undertake actions to prevent us from doing. If you take in terms of rockets and all, it's all okay. But in terms of surveillance, China is outstanding. Surveillance is one of the tasks of artillery. And when you look at it, surveillance is today not artillery alone. It's a combination of space. It's a combination of drones. It's a combination of the other surveillance devices located on ground. When you look at surveillance today, Chinese satellites, well, there are plenty of satellites roaming around over Eastern Ladakh. We have totally, I think, about 14 satellites dedicated from ISRO for what you call, which are low Earth observation satellites, which can provide some sort of data, which I think is absolutely minimal. For Eastern Ladakh, at least, the minimum number of satellites which the army needs, which the army does not have a single satellite right now, is 6 satellites. And well, you say, how am I relating it to artillery? Because ultimately, all surveillance ultimately falls under the purview of artillery. Despite the fact that the UAVs have now moved to Aviation Corps or anybody else, the point is the surveillance centers still come under artillery. Artillery can do no task till they know where the target is, unless the target can only be known by surveillance. Now, this is as regards China. You get left given another country, which is Pakistan. Well, Pakistan right now has got a mix of still, you know, shall I put it, Western and Chinese equipment. Broadly, they are now gradually moving on as far as the 155s are concerned and rockets are concerned to a Chinese variety. And when they are moving on to this variety, they are what you call much qualitatively at a much lesser distance. In terms of quantity, well, I would put it the Indian artillery far outwits that, because on the Pakistan border, our deployments are very good. We are meeting adequate densities. We can cater for all threats, mainly because you must understand that Pakistan occupies borders in regions which are extremely sensitive. We have seen what you call almost, shall I put it, 4 wars and 1 major conflict. And in this, you must have seen in all times, Pakistan, as far as the 3 wars they were concerned, often their objective was Delhi, at least in 65. Or in 48, the objective was Kashmir. Now imagine today when an armored division, if it had crossed what you call Taran Taran and Khem Karan, it would be on the bridges, which the 3 bridges of Punjab. And next is to drive on to Delhi. And believe me, when once the front defenses collapse, thereafter it becomes very easy. So with regard to Pakistan, we are well deployed, well poised. We have adequate quantities. But please remember that these quantities often have to be moved on the Chinese border. Because if there is what you call any major conflict, today we visualize it will happen from the northern adversary. So that's why, as far as artillery is concerned, this is the one issue. And the next which I'll point out is that possibly in terms of missiles, that you see, we just have one supersonic cruise missile with the Indian Army, which is the BrahMos. The other missiles are all nuclear tipped. They do not have a conventional capability. Chinese have been able to have their rocket force, which is based on conventional as well as nuclear. That is, they can all fire conventional missiles as well as nuclear. So they have a high in quantity of missiles which can be used. That gives them a major advantage. And combine this with various other domains of warfare, which is basically cyber, and then space, and then what you call artificial intelligence. Chinese are definitely outstanding. They are today having now, wherever the Chinese soldiers are not in adequate quantity, robots have already come into Tibet. That is the level at which China is functioning technologically. Just last sentence before I finish this question. On 26 November, I was lucky to interact with General Bipin Rawat, the late CDS, and he had described technology as the fifth pillar. Now, very important sentences. God bless his soul, he is no more, but it is a sentence which is extremely important. My latest book, which is just at its final stages, it's with the publisher for about three or four corrections. It's on technologies for future technologies for the Indian Army. So unless we get these technologies up, artillery will remain possibly behind, as I brought out, in two areas with regard to China, surveillance, and next is with regard to missiles and rockets. Pakistan is nothing but an appendage of China. Therefore, whatever Pakistan would always require Chinese assistance to counter India. Professionally, they are as competent as us. We cannot underestimate. So keeping that in mind, we have two viable threats, which from the artillery point of view, and we have to keep our Western, that is what you call neighbor, as well occupied as the Northern. I have finished on this question.
Right, sir. I mean, this was good and exhaustive and a point of view which, you know, not many would like to actually understand, because, you know, we like very, very true, Indians, we would say, no, we are the best, we've got everything. But then always there's a wish list, and with wish list also comes the capability which has to come either from abroad via exports, via imports. Or, you know, we make them in India, we have the Atmanirbhar Bharat, we have the Make in India, but we definitely want the capability. Now, two things which we want to understand, which I think our audience would like to know, is that when it comes to Indian artillery, are we capable enough to export with what is being made at the moment under Make in India and Atmanirbhar Bharat? And also that... having M777s and, is it sufficient? Have we got everything which we wanted? So that's something which I'd like to understand from you, sir. It will normally come from the horse's mouth and from you at the moment.
Well, see, I would put it that as far as the artillery is concerned, it's always inadequate. Any country will say, because firepower is, requirement is unlimited. You know, leave the artillery, let's go to an issue called nuclear weapons. Let us look at the number of nuclear weapons which Russia and the United States, they amassed during the Cold War. Even today, the number of nuclear weapons they have is something which you just say, if I list it out for you, you'll say, what are they going to do with it? So similarly, artillery, you can have as many, but believe me, the numbers would always be less. Why? Because ultimately, when you look at such a big country like India, you feel that you could be vulnerable at so many points. And today, where nobody else can reach the artillery can reach. Even if you take an aircraft or a UAV, it needs favorable weather. The artillery shell does not need favorable weather. So it's an all-pervading mechanism. And therefore, artillery is something which is absolutely, but we have got to optimize. We've got to come in for something which is, you know, really, what should I say, which fulfills your optimum capabilities. And as of now, when you said that our capability to export, well, as far as some equipment is concerned, it can be exported. Like I'll just give you, L&T has made the K9 Vajra, provided, you know, there are many issues involved with export. After all, firstly, it involves the sanction of our own government. As far as the Indian Army is concerned, their order was 100, they've already made. Now we have an order for another 50 more to look at possibly the high altitude, they'll make those 50. After that, we must export. If you don't export, even the M777, possibly we must get into an agreement with the makers, which is Lockheed Martin, with what you call, and come to an agreement that, please, if you allow us, let's, you know, what you call, get down to BAE system, must allow us to what you call export this, because we need many more M777s. Our requirement is unsatiable. But while we are doing this, whatever you do, you require to sustain yourself. That industry which is supplying you must sustain. If you want yourself to sustain, you must export. Similarly, all other equipment, I don't want to go into the details. Of course, there are issues here or there. Whenever we make an item, at least I have been advocating from even when I was in service, at least 20% you should be able to export. We have laid down some targets. You have mentioned all these policies. But by 2025, the Prime Minister has said $5 billion should be defense exports. Well, I would not like to, you know, what you call, say anything, but I think this is a minimal figure. I'm not saying optimum, it's a minimal figure. If you want, let's say, today, I've just received the Chinese budget in 2049 is going to be $47 trillion. Today it is $200 billion. Just look at it now today. $47 trillion. I mean, it's something which today India's GDP is just about $3 trillion. I'm just giving you the figures. If the defense budget of China, which is at 2049, that is which you call today from today, 28 years, is going to be 15 times what our GDP is, then where is this money going to come for our equipment? We can't be lagging behind. After all, it means that so much of AI is going to come in, so much of issues are going to come in, that China today would be looking at issues possibly in a pure technological way. So exports are a must. We can export. What is the difficulty? If today China can export, so can we. Pakistan is exporting. I think possibly Pakistan exports are very high. Mind you, they have a few ordnance factories or what you call these factories, and they are exporting. I think overall, when you look at Pakistan policies before the 65 war, believe me, they were a better economy than us. You look at Bangladesh today. I mean to say, despite anything, they are buying 75% of their equipment from China. Why? Because we cannot give them at a rate which is possibly a rate which allows them to do good business. Even Sri Lanka, I don't have to keep naming one after the other. So exports, we can do. It's not at all difficult to export, let me tell you. As a matter of fact, a country like Japan, I mean to say, look at it, it imports steel from India. And imports iron ore from India. There are so many trains which carry iron ore right up to Visakhapatnam. And it goes to the ships. I've seen in Japan, the ships are lying next to the steel plant. And they return back with steel. What a great thing. Not a single gram of iron is produced in Japan. And today they are giving you steel, TV, cars. So therefore export England if you take UK. What grows in England? I remember first time I landed in England, the only thing I and my wife found was green grass. Grass was extremely green when you look at the Lord's pitch. But look at their export capability even today. So exports have got nothing to do with resources. Our resources are outstanding. Whether you take human resources, you take anything, you take Indian doctors, you take everything. I mean, so they are the best the world has today. So all that you need is possibly a good policy, a good, what you call, approach, and what you call understanding that sustenance is based on export. That's all.
Right, sir. I mean, that was very nicely and exhaustively explained. But sir, in addition to this, when we go ahead, there is another thing which is a matter of concern to us, which is unmanned systems. And, you know, we've had a lot of these infiltrations through the unmanned systems. And where do we stand? Because when we see the Chinese Annual Day Parade, we see those swarm drones there. And then when we also had a very good technical demonstration last year Army Day. And Chief yesterday in his press conference said that we will not be left wanting for anything. But sir, where do we stand when it comes to unmanned systems?
As somebody who has commanded a brigade with unmanned systems, and then had the pleasure of even seeing BrahMos missiles being fired even after retirement, I'll put it, I would very clearly say that our capabilities are very high. We have to focus on it. Firstly, we are already making tactical UAVs. It's not only an unmanned system in terms of purely aircraft and vehicles. The artificial intelligence sector needs to be, we have had many committees. We had the Chandrasekhar committee and we had so many committees. The point is, how are you today optimizing these committees into actualities on ground? You want things to fructify on research. The answer is the private sector. I'm not talking in manufacture, I'm talking research. And who does the research in private sector? It is not going to be L&T or Tata. They will not do research. It is the MSME. These are the people who need to be funded. Today we are funding Vodafone, we are funding Tata, what is this, TCA, Tata Communications and everybody. You fund these MSMEs, you will reach a stage where you can do wonders with UAVs, wonders with artificial intelligence as an entire subject. So as far as drones is concerned, whether you want unmanned ships to go there, submarines to move, you want anything, there's no difficulty. We have people who are capable. We have businessmen with the acumen to do it. I have met businessmen, believe me or not, on cyber. And luckily invited one of them for dinner. He says, even if the government doesn't fund us, we will be able to go ahead. Can you imagine such a thing? Countering cyber, I mean, says, I don't want to name him, but I requested IDSA that he should come and give a talk. Well, it's really very difficult to, get government organizations to do that. But the point is, that is our capability today. People who are living, particularly in a city called Bangalore, you have to know them. Means it's not that you go and see what is going on, what the TV focuses on Bangalore, so many people on issues which are, shall I say, not technically related. You get into the details of the technology they have been able to achieve. You will be wonderstruck. Not only in terms of startups, in terms of, where people are doing things on their own. Today, you are getting UAVs in your operational sector from Bangalore and Hyderabad. Hyderabad is nothing but, you see, it's a sister city of Bangalore, having lived in Bangalore in the army and seen and studied them. And thereafter, placing so many orders on Colonel Shankar and others from Bangalore. I can only say one thing. We can do all this. And it does not mean that you get the actual technology. See, nobody can today get the actual technology. Let's say if today we don't manufacture an engine. China also does not manufacture an engine. It's not that we don't have the capability to manufacture. Moment I tell Mahindra, I spoke to Mahindra, why didn't you meet? He says, the moment I spend my energy in making that engine, that much of time is lost. Why not buy it? So if you get out to the MSMEs and you want that to happen, you can have all these things. Numbers. Now the whole issue is, see, often it's a misnomer, I'll put it, that if you spend money on defense, it's a wastage of national resource. This is the popular feeling, or this is the classical feeling, shall I say. Believe me, there cannot be anything more far from the truth for a practitioner. Because when you sit down with your pen and paper, you'll find today amongst all the services, you take the private sector, you'll find people in the armed forces anywhere in the world are the least paid. They are the least paid, yet when you go to their areas, when you go to them, they are able to manage within that. and they are able to manage your security and they don't ask for anything. So therefore, for you to spend on defense, as I said, I gave you the Chinese budget. The US budget is today $600 billion. And you know what our GDP is. It's just hovering around 3.5. We are looking at a $5 trillion economy. And we pray to God we reach there. But the point is, how much is the defense budget? About $50 billion. About in and around combining everything. With that, what can you get? So what do you do? You have to today understand that you are what you are saying, exports. I think you made the issues absolutely right. Making of this artificial, because these are the force multipliers which are going to win. Satellites, drones, these are your future, which I've written in my book, which I've been writing every day. If you get satellites, you get drones. Today, prosperity lies in this. And I'll say in the conquest of outer space. The earlier you do it, the better it is. Before rules come in, which stop you from. So today we should exploit space, artificial intelligence to the maximum. And companies in Bangalore are capable of doing it.
And also, sir, there, a few days back, we read a news item which said that there are robotic soldiers sent by China. Now, what is this, sir? Is there a regiment of robotic soldiers? What is it? I mean, we just wanted to hear. I'm sure you being an expert in China would definitely know that.
You'd be surprised. I've written a lot of issues on artificial intelligence and many people all over the world ask me. I'm very happy you have come to this lovely subject of artificial. I've been writing on it and writing about combat robots. And obviously, we're taken very seriously by Indian scientists, by Indian technologists. But people in India generally don't believe that these things exist. Well, China has been on the field of artificial intelligence, particularly I leave China. I often say the Chinese Politburo has all technocrats in their Politburo. Now, just understand what I'm talking. I'll repeat it. All the Politburo, which is the most powerful body of policy making in a country, is full of technocrats. Xi Jinping is himself a technocrat. And this was started by Jiang Zemin, rather Deng Xiaoping actually introduced, to get in technology. Why is it that Russia collapsed? Why is it China is not collapsing? How is it that, both systems are the same? Or the Communist Party is the same? But today you find that China is moving ahead. It's able to adapt because you've got technocrats on top. You've got their alliances right. They are able to handle situations which they happen. And now when we look at it, as far as this issue is concerned, all that I would say is that we need to really get into this aspect of policy making and budgeting and other things in a way which is favorable to us, looking at technology in a more favorable way and seeing that we are able to get it. If you want further details, it's a very, very detailed issue you have asked. Anything more on this question you want, you would have to really point at me, because it'll go into really a very detailed answer.
And just a minute. So I just wanted to understand one thing, sir, and which was that, is the concept of a robotic soldier there in China? And will they be able to fight traditional wars like the normal soldiers, human being soldiers fight? Are they humanoids? And how and when will India react to this technological marvel which China has thrust, on the world? So I just wanted to understand that.
I've written about robots, armies, I've written about it. They exist in two countries, United States, which is number one, and the second is China. Now, robots, they don't look like human beings. You'll not find a human robo which you find in, what is that picture? I'm just forgetting. I had seen a lovely movie. Yeah, not Terminator, but it was another movie. And, it had all the robos and robos fighting. No, not that, those type of robos. It can be in the shape of a lizard. It can be in the shape of a vehicle. It can be in the shape of anything that which is controlled artificially, has a gun, and is able to attack. You'll not even know that it looks like a human being. They don't have to shape it like a human being. Today you've got Indus School Bangalore, where about 3 subjects are being taught by robots. You've got restaurants in Bangalore where orders are being taken by robots. The front desk is all robotic in Bangalore, I'm just saying. So what is the difficulty today in doing some tasks, which I'll say, surveillance. In Israel, the entire surveillance is robotic or artificial intelligence. There is no man in Europe today guarding any ammunition dump, any bank, nothing. There's a lock. There are cameras and there are response forces. You must have seen this in a number of Netflix movies and all. I don't have to come on to this. Well, robotic soldiers are there. Well, if you ask me, can they undertake combat? The answer is obviously no. Not as yet, but they can undertake command and control, you know, a lot of decisions. Logistics is purely under robotics, both by China and the US. They've even entered Tibet. Wherever the sentries are getting tired in high altitude, it's better to have robots placed. Robot does not mean that you see a man over there. It may be just a camera with a gun. Now, to get these shapes into us, unless we get into it, we will possibly, you know, be caught. We will not be knowing that somebody is attacking us. Because when robots attack, they will not make any sound. They'll suddenly be there. And when they arrive, they may arrive with a drone. They could be dropped from a drone. I don't want to give ideas because many of my ideas, you know, they get replicated and I have been warned not to give it to you. So I don't want to give you the actual answers because I have a lot of ideas. I've been implementing them on ground and while I was in the army. So I wouldn't like to, because they're not, I know, classified, but you see, those ideas are more classified than, because I have the way how things can be captured. Today, robots can be dropped anywhere. You are undertaking a mission and some lizards and ants are roaming around and they turn out to be robots. They attack the dignitaries concerned and thereafter they go back or they perish. They get self-exploded. And what is it's an inexpensive thing. It's not at all expensive. So they are there in various forms. They are available today and they are being experimented. Xi Jinping started this artificial intelligence in 2012. The next war which Xi Jinping is planning, he's planning it with robots. And this is what I would like to say.
Yes, sir, that was wonderful, actually, you know, and so much to talk about. And it's really, you are a storehouse of information, and especially on China, sir, because I have seen a book you've written on China. If you have it handy, sir, can you please show it to our audience, the book you wrote on Chinese military?
Thank you. It's actually, it's an assessment of Chinese military modernization. This is the book. And you can see it.
Okay.
And this was I must thank Vivekananda, International Foundation for releasing the book along with Pentagon Press. So, and so many people have referred to it. Obviously, the modernization is going on, but it goes into many, many issues. And what I think it's the opening chapter is very important, where I was able to dig out the 6 wars which China wishes to fight and the years in which they fight. And these 6, I would say broadly, I'll just quickly just summarize, is the first war is with what you call obviously for Taiwan by 2025. You can see it's going on as per that. You believe me, this book I finished about 2 years or 2.5 years ago. But 2025 is Taiwan. The next is South China Sea by about 2030. After that, they come to India. So India is actually, the war will be around 20. We got to still some time. Before they get on to the war, what's happening right now is actually a warming up session. Okay. And then after that, they go on to Inner Mongolia and finally they sort out Russia. All this by 2049. So
right,
the book,
that's a prediction.
And the book, they have written, it's not my prediction. The Chinese have written, it's in from a blog called The One Way Po in Hong Kong. The Chinese, what they are doing, they are an enigma. But I was able to dig out, and believe me, I've given the timelines. And it's working out beautifully. If you watch right now, their focus actually is on Taiwan.
Right, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Actually, wonderful, sir. And thank you so much, sir. It was really wonderful. And, you know, we cannot sum up everything in one session. So I think we really need another session to talk about. You know, when we talk about China, we always talk about China and, you know, enemies it's created for itself. But we must give it a credit that courtesy China, we have so many alliances in the world. We've got so many countries who become friends, and we've so many, you know, countries who are ready to stand for you if China even sneezes. So, you know, that is something which is wonderful. And sir, we'll thank you very much for this wonderful session. And I really hope, you know, when we are here for the Indian Army Day, going to happen a few days hence. And we really hope that, you know, we have I feel we have the best army in the world. And it can fight anybody. And definitely, sir, we feel that, you know, once, you know, we get everything which we want, everything on our wish list, I think no country should be able to, you know, stand up in front of us. And, you know, keeping that in mind, well, let's move ahead with a big Jai Hind. And we go back to our studios in Europe, where Chaitali is waiting for us to finish. Thank you so much, Chaitali. It was such a wonderful session. We forgot the timeline you'd given us.
It was really very intriguing hearing, sir. As usual, he has so much of information and so much of new ideas to give, which is for a generation like us. Yes, it is something to hear. Thank you so much, sir. As usual, it was great listening to you, and thanks for your precious time to ADU. Thank you so much, ma'am, for the session. We would look forward to meet you again, sir, in this chat room in near future. Thanks. Have a great day ahead.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chaitali.
Jai Hind.
Jai Hind.